try that. Mm. There we go.
Why do you feel bad for Canada again?
Nope, bit's gone.
Damn it.
It'll come up in the movie, I'm sure. Oh, Lord, why are we doing this? Yeah, well, my phone is now fucked up. So, Sam, what are we doing? What are we watching?
Ready Player One.
The movie! A Monday warrior, mean
stride. Today's Tom Sawyer, mean pride. Tonight, the Grey Cup presents The Hookup.
He's a visionary. I just wanted a guy to yell in Spanish. That really sucked.
Stop bites.
What a crappy movie. Oh, see, here's what I wanted to do, Sam. I wanted you and me to go to this movie at the premiere and be Abe and what's his name from Simpsons and be like, boo, boo, I want to see the manager. Wow, that was a movie. Reboot the Guardian Code coming out soon. Oh man, that Sam, how'd that feel, buddy? We can talk about this.
That's what we're here for. Yeah, it wasn't as bad as the book.
Yeah, it wasn't.
It was pretty bad.
It was bad. It was a bad movie.
Yeah.
I feel like we were missing half of it somehow, despite it being 2 hours.
Despite the fact that the first 10 minutes were literally a voiceover explaining the movie. Oh, yeah, we're doing this. This is the podcast. Welcome to the podcast. It's a podcast.
I wish there was more Tracer. And Reaper was there. I wanted more Reaper. I wanted him to say his catchphrase.
What is that catchphrase?
Sorry, I'm doing a Justin. I'm laughing before I say my joke.
No, I'm laughing at nothing. I'm laughing at nothing.
Reaper Man here. Next.
Is that a reference to Blue Oyster Cult?
Was there a reference to Blue Oyster Cult in this movie?
Probably. Scene? Probably. It was a reference to every fucking thing. That's a reference.
I feel like whenever we make a reference for the rest of our lives, whenever we refer to something, we should have like a sound bite or like a that was easy button. That's just like, that's a reference.
Yeah.
That'd be a loud movie.
That was a 2-hour fucking movie.
That guy got kicked in the dick so hard his suit turned orange.
It's an interesting feature to include in a still suit.
I saw a guy get, like, a not even a hand job. His, like, genitals through his pants were touched. That was blue.
Yes.
So what's red?
So there's good touch and there's bad touch.
What's red, though? I imagine there's a whole LED spectrum of color on that
side. Oh, my God. You're making this movie even worse.
No, I'm getting invested in the lore and in the setting for what it is.
Woof.
I have to say it.
Okay.
And I think this is going to be antithetical to who I am as a person.
Uh-huh.
Bright is a better movie than this movie. It's really close. It's really close.
Okay. Sell me on this.
But Bright is bad in ways that are interesting. Mm-hmm. This was just boring.
Yeah.
This was just dumb.
Wow, I never thought... Yeah. Because like, Bright actually has a plot.
Well, Bright is... One, Bright is a plot. Yeah. Two, Bright is bad in ways that are laughable.
Yes.
And there were a few moments
here. There's quite a few moments.
That were bad, that were laughable. Yeah. But it was mostly just arduous.
Yeah. Well, there was a point right in like nearing the end, like the fourth, fifth. I was just like, yeah, this is just happening now. It just washes over you.
I didn't have that. Mostly because you're pretty entertaining to watch this
movie. Yeah, I do. I do make it a fun time for all. My constant vexation.
I want to watch Witch Hunter Robin again.
No, you just don't.
Apropos of nothing. I do, though, for real.
Should we explain to the audience what exactly that means?
No, we're going to cut that part out.
Okay, all right.
Or we're not.
We're not going to cut that part out. No. Post-production Sam will not be removing that.
Surprise, post-production Sam actually does cut it out.
It's possible.
So
I don't, he's capable of anything these days.
So I have a lot of questions.
Okay.
That never get answered by the book, I figure.
Oh, let's test me out. Let's do Ready Player One trivia time.
So the entire economy of this world is based in this game.
Yes.
And it's based in the currency of the game.
Yes. Which is worth more, as the book mentions, than the American dollar.
So all international trade is done in this game.
Is conducted in this game.
Yes. So everything's done in this game.
Yes.
So
I feel like your degree is about to be meaningful in our podcast.
No.
All right, get to your point.
I don't think I have a point. I think I just needed to know that this was the most important game ever made.
Yes.
Including such media luminaries that made it, including Stephen Wright, who was found drawn and quartered, and
Andrew W.K.
Andrew W.K., I missed you so much.
Party tip, don't watch this movie.
He was in E3 this year.
Was he?
Andrew W.K. Oh. Yeah, they had a lot of weird musical performances, and Andrew W.K. was one of them. And I was really sad because he's basically a one-hit wonder.
Is he?
Yeah.
I mean, he seems more popular than that, though.
Well, like that's the weird thing.
Pop culture currency.
Like, he has pop culture currency, but he made one album that everyone loved.
Hmm.
And every other album after that was kind of a failure. Because, like, one of those failures was, like, he covered a bunch of, like, J-pop songs.
That sounds like Andrew W.K.
Well, here's the thing. Andrew W.K. is literally a 4chan nerd. That's who he is as a human being. He's a guy from 4chan who's just got successful one day. He's the real life equivalent of, like...
Yeah, but no, but he's really, like, he's very, like, social justice-y, which is not very 4chan.
4chan is more diaspora. That's not the right word. More divergent than you seem to think it is.
I know that it's not all just evil, but, I mean, the stereotypical 4chan nerd, you would admit, is not a social justice warrior.
I would say that the average 4chan user has a wide political spectrum. The average poll user is not that.
Okay. Would you say that the average 4chan mover user would like this movie?
Yes.
Oh, you're not helping your argument.
Well, I didn't say they were good people. I said they were. I said they were.
They have a diversity of political opinion.
I wanted to be able to just call Andrew W.K. right now and be like, hey, Andrew W.K., do you like Ready Player One? Andrew W.K., be on our podcast.
What was the highlight of this? Not watching this movie, but watching me suffer through it.
I think my highlight was when you said, rightly, reboot the Guardian Code coming out this May, and I tried to throttle you.
So the part where I referenced a better piece of media...
Reboot the Guardian Code?
No, the Wooly joke.
Wooly, be on our podcast.
Yeah.
Wooly Madden from Montreal. Fly to Vancouver, a city you probably don't like very much. I feel like the big injustice of this plot and of this movie, and I think you're going to shoot me, is that it's not a game. Like, this should have been a video game. It'd be a badly written video game. But it would be
I actually agree with you.
It would be on par with Dot Hack.
Because if it were a video game, you could interact with those references rather than just have characters on a screen scream them at you.
Well, but it's also like all that screaming references at you, that is video game writing generally. Mm-hmm. It's that bad.
Mm.
More often than not, that is the quality of writing in a video game.
Jacob's a sociologist. He knows.
Don't appeal to authority on a shitty podcast. Don't make me hate you as a person, Sam.
I think we're well past that point.
Yeah, if it were a single player game and you made that awful abomination avatar and you had a sassy...
Man, all the characters look so bad.
I liked Iron Giant when he beat up the man.
It's kind of hard to screw up the Iron Giant, like... I'm just talking about the people look awful online.
Well, there were only three actual people, and then everyone else was a reference to something.
You know what this movie has a weird quality of doing? Showing us characters as if we've met them and we know them and we understand them, telling us how great they are.
1980s reference. I think that's excusable.
Is it?
If
you
were the writer reading his own work. Which I think is the big problem here, because you know what I recognize in this writing? My writing. Ooh. My very bad writing.
I've read your stuff, and you are not.
But this is the problem. It's an actual psychological thing in very young children.
Yeah.
Who like they watch a ball being hidden.
Yeah.
And then they see someone looking for the ball, and they're like, of course they'll find the ball, because I know where the ball is, so they should know where the ball is.
Oh, okay.
It's a type of, like, logical not being able to other people correctly.
Oh, I see. Not being able to separate, yeah.
Yeah, not being able to separate knowledge.
Okay, and so you're saying, like,
that's the problem.
Like a small child, you read yourself into this movie.
Well, like you're a small child... Writers read themselves into their fiction and go, well, of course people will get it.
Oh. No,
people are too dumb to figure it out because they didn't write it. You idiot. Sam Young. So, like, a lot of mysteries have that problem because, like, the writer of a mystery
that's always the problem of mystery novels. Either it's too complicated and no one will get it and it's unfair, or it's too easy. I would adjust that slightly.
Long-winded bullshit, go ahead.
And that, yes, as a writer, you read into your own writing too much so that you can't see that it's too contextual, that it's only for you.
Yeah.
But also you don't see it's very, very bad and that it's not, there's no logic to it.
Well, what I imagine would happen...
It's like you don't see your logical gaps.
Well, here's a hypothetical dream scenario for you.
Okay.
There was a draft of this original novel that never explained a single reference. Never.
Oh, I doubt it.
No. Hear me out.
Okay.
But there were tons of references.
Sure.
But the sentence structure would be like... maybe a few explanations for like and then it'll say it would be a sentence like she's wearing a Def Jam shirt, and that would be it. And then a very bad publisher read that sentence and looked to the writer and said, "Marty, who's the actual
Marty?
Writer?
Who's no Ernest Klein?
Ernie,
yeah,
Ernie. What's this Def Jam thing?" And then he explains Def Jam to the publisher, and the publisher's like, I'm not going to get Def Jam. The kids out there, they're not going to get the Def Jams.
It's funny, because that was a theory of mine, is that the editorial... I don't think...
The publishers.
Yeah, the publishers, whatever. But my theory was that, yes, a lot of the references weren't as contextual as they were in the book, which is still bad. I think it's bad if you're just like spouting off references, but that I think his editor or the publisher or whatever,
someone
like,
said
you gotta dumb it down a tad,
you gotta explain this shit,
because I can't quite imagine that an author thinks his audience is that stupid.
Well, more just like, I need to tell you everything, kid. I need to explain this in full detail. I think the masturbation chapter was there in full.
Chapter. We're kind of falling into the book, though. We should be talking about the movie.
No, Sam, this is about, like, the journey. This is part two.
Part two of...
Of your breakout, talking about how much you hate this book. I'm talking breakout as in not our show, The Breakout.
Oh, okay.
It's not even a show. It's one episode called The Breakout. I'm talking about your first foray into this world that you... This magical universe... that you invested yourself in, which is called the universe of hating the book Ready Player One.
See, I'm kind of over it at this point, honestly. I mean, more than I was.
You are lying to me.
I don't feel the same red hot rage as I did before.
Did you wear a Joy Division t-shirt? Oh, I hate this movie.
Wow. Oh my god, all the things they're keeping from the fucking book is this line.
God, it is. Ugh. All these songs are like...
This isn't what I really look like. This isn't my real body.
Obviously.
I love this movie. It's speaking for me. It speaks to me, about you. You don't understand my 80s references.
Don't praise the movie!
This is like being in an abusive relationship. You get red hot, you yell, you scream, you froth at the mouth, and you say to me, your brother Fredo, I'm not
you
like
broke
them.
My heart.
You broke my heart, Fredo. I knew it was you.
Oh my god, we're making references. We have to stop.
Those are 70s references. 70s references. Ooh, kill lady references.
There you go. Okay.
So, okay.
Oddly enough, I buy that.
This is a bad movie.
Yes.
And it's bad because it's kind of incomprehensible in terms of its plot. It's skipping huge gaps of things. You can follow along barely.
Yeah, I don't... It's bad
because
think...
T.J. Miller's in it.
Yes.
Although, I will say, once more, T.J. Miller is perfect for this movie.
In more ways than one.
And I mean this without any hint of irony or disrespect mm-hmm. to a guy who calls in bomb threats. Mm. I think that this is good for T.J. Miller. That said...
I think it breaks even, you have to admit.
What makes me mad about this is that this is a book / movie about video games that don't understand what video games are.
Yeah. Well, if you read the book especially, he doesn't really know how modern video gaming works.
Well, like, why did he have to go through the see-through green glass thing?
Mm-hmm.
Why did he have to do that?
Why he do that?
Half in the bag. Why do you have to do that? I've been drinking a lot. I don't like women and black people in my movies. I think that's weird.
That's not entirely fair.
And uncomfortable. It makes me... Like, he's playing a character. I get that.
I see.
Isn't he? Or is that just
him? Who are we talking about?
The guy who does Half in the Bag. Half in the Bag stuff.
I don't know Half in the Bag.
Okay, we're going to have to watch a lot
of stuff. We're going to have to get through some things.
It's a bad movie. It's
very bad.
The Jez was right. It's a bad movie, but the book is also bad.
Friend of the podcast, Jess, was correct. It's very, very bad.
No, the Jez. Who's never listened. He's the one human being I found who was like, this movie is terrible. The book was so much better.
Oh, see, because my friend Jess said it wasn't very good.
Well, friend of the podcast, Jess, who I've never... Wait, no, she...
You've met her once.
In passing?
Yeah.
Anyway. Hey, Jess, who I gave $100 to.
I forgot about that.
Who is, I guess, a human being who didn't give me her poem. Is like...
No, she did give you it.
I didn't fucking read it. The point is...
You're such a good partner.
I forgot what it was. You kept distracting me with your laughs. Do over. Sam, edit this part out.
Do over.
The point of this movie is that it's bad. It's a bad movie. It's a shitty movie. It's a movie that is missing lots of beats despite it being 2 hours.
Mm-hmm. God, it was 2 hours.
There's a lot of internal logic beats that are missing. There's some visual stuff that's nice, but like...
Yeah.
Spielberg does that. If a Spielberg movie looked bad, I'd shoot myself.
Spielberg's got the wonder thing going, kind of.
No. There was no...
I mean, Spielberg himself, not this movie.
Yeah, the Spielberg wonder was not in this movie.
No.
The Spielberg sense of, like, magic and youth was not in this movie.
You know what was weird is the soundtrack was very Spielbergian, and I thought it really didn't fit at all.
Well, it was awkward because it was... Spielbergian.
Spielbergian.
And then it was also like 80s reference songs that fit for the movie.
Oh, man.
But like, we're very against Spielberg's ethos of like, here's this ethereal childlike, like the song that plays while a child is playing in their room.
Yes. Why does he have a boy? He has a boy. Well, why is he keeping a boy?
It's young him.
Yeah, but it's still keeping a boy. At the end of the movie,
there's a twist ending to this movie where he closes the door and it's like the young boy gets to grow up inside of the Oasis.
Oh.
He's like an AI that lives inside of it, and the like older AI like shoots itself, it like self-terminates. So like he gets to live again through the Oasis.
You know, with that, that 10 seconds of dialogue, that was a
reference. That whole thing was a reference, you fucking idiot, you goof. I got you, dumb motherfucker. I got you in my dumb reference, you bullshit asshole.
It's a reference to
Dot Hack. That's the plot of Dot Hack.
Oh, I hate everything. Oh,
we'd like to thank Irritating Rainbow for providing our... incomprehensible. This is a really incomprehensible episode. It was just us being...
We'd like to thank Murray Head, actually, because I'll probably use One Night in Bangkok again.
We'd like to thank Murray Head for not being in Ready Player One.
Yes.
Either the book or the movie.
Yes.
We'd also like to thank the musical Chess for existing.
Yep.
We'd also like to thank the musical that doesn't exist, Chess 2. Chess 2. Deep Blue Earth.
Deeper Blue. Deep. Chess 2, Deeper Blue.
Chess 2, Deeper Blue.
We really need to get on that.
And it has a sequel to One Night in Bangkok, and it's like, Tonight in Tokyo, We Tonight Dance. Tonight in
Tokyo. I like that.
And it's actually covered by Ninja Sex Party. Man, this is a whole musical I've invented.
Yeah, TM.
Sam,
final
thoughts? It's not a thought.
It's all you get.
I feel like that's what it should end. That's all you get. Oy. Why is my arm numb? My entire
right. Nerve here.
Well, because this part's numb too.
No, that's probably it then.
Well,
shake it out. Starting to tingle.
I'm having a panic attack.
That'd be weird for one arm to have. Anyway.
It's also kind of the other arm too a bit. I'm gonna die. Exit the warrior today, Tom Sawyer. He gets high.